Well, g'day and welcome to the Northern Illawarra Uniting Church sermon for this Sunday, August 13th. It is good to be with all of you and it's good to be back here in the church. Today we are starting a new sermon series on one of the most remarkable stories that Jesus tells, one of the most beloved and a story that has inspired people's imaginations from the very moment that Jesus first told it. We're going to spend 3 weeks looking at the parable of the Good Samaritan. So let's read it first. You can find it on Luke chapter 10, starting in verse 25, and we'll pop it up here on the screen for you. Let's read it together. Just then a lawyer stood up to test Jesus. "Teacher," he said, "what must I do to inherit eternal life?" And he said to him, "What is written in the law? What do you read there?" And he answered, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul, and with all your strength and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself." And Jesus said to him, "You have given the right answer. Do this and you will live." But wanting to justify himself, he asked Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" Jesus replied, "A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell into the hands of robbers who stripped him and beat him and went away, leaving him half dead. Now, by chance, a priest was going down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. So likewise, a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him and passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, while traveling, came near him, and when he saw him, he was moved with pity. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, having poured oil and wine on them. And then he put him on his own animal and brought him to an inn and took care of him. The next day he took out 2 denarii and gave them to the innkeeper and said, 'Take care of him. And when I come back, I will repay you whatever more you spend.' Which of these three do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of the robbers?" And he said to the one who showed him mercy. And Jesus said to him, "Go and do likewise." The word of the Lord. Well, we are beginning, like I said, a new sermon series today, a 3-week deep dive on this amazing and beloved story of Jesus. In fact, maybe one of the most famous stories that Jesus tells. So well known, in fact, that the name of the story is the term that we use for anyone today who does a good deed. Anyone who does something good in our world today, we tend to say they are a good Samaritan. Anyone who goes the extra mile, anyone who does something out of the ordinary to care for somebody. In fact, I had a hard time researching this sermon because every time you Google the term Good Samaritan, you don't get resources on Jesus' story. You get a long list of news items about everyday Good Samaritans doing good things. It's kind of inspiring, actually. Here's a few examples that I came up with just on a simple Google of Good Samaritan. Mysterious Good Samaritan helps man plow driveway. Good Samaritan helps fellow boaters escape a flaming vessel. A Good Samaritan saves terrified 5-year-old from raccoon attack. And my favorite, Good Samaritan stops child abduction with jiu-jitsu. It seems there are Good Samaritans everywhere doing quite incredible things. And of course, we admire these Good Samaritans. I mean, I hope that if I ever get caught unawares on camera, it will be being a Good Samaritan, not sleeping with my mouth open on a bus or something like that. In fact, being a Good Samaritan in these stories seems kind of awesome. Who wouldn't want to stop child abductions with jiu-jitsu? Jesus has clearly captured something with this story, touching on one of our deepest hopes as people, that we would be good, maybe even inspiring people. Good Samaritans, good Australians, good men, good women. Perhaps that's what a sermon on the Good Samaritan should be about, inspiring you and me to do good. Well, maybe. And to be honest with you, I think we'll get there. But there's a little something more that I want to tug at as we start to look at this story. You see, the story starts in a surprising way. It's not just a story that Jesus tells for no reason. It's in response to a question. We're told that a lawyer stands up to test Jesus. A lawyer in those days, in Jesus' day, would have been an expert in the ancient Jewish law of the Talmud and the Torah. Someone who asked deep questions of God's word and considered how you live in light of God's law. And his question is really a profound one, one of the great questions that Jesus receives. What must I do to inherit eternal life? If you strip away that fancy language, he's really asking a question that we might all ask. What makes for real, lasting life? What makes for the good life? What makes me right and good and truly human? What makes us what we are really supposed to be? And Jesus, it seems, knowing that he's speaking with a very intelligent, a well-read lawyer, asks him a question in return. What do you read in the law? And the lawyer answers. He says, well, what we're told in the law is to love God with our whole heart, with our whole soul, and with our whole strength, and with our whole mind. That's the ancient words going back to one of the most famous passages in the Old Testament, the Shema, the Hear, O Israel passage in Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 4 through 7. But then the lawyer does something a little fancy. He adds a second line, not just love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. He goes to a deep cut, a passage from Leviticus. Leviticus chapter 19 that says, love your neighbor as yourself. And so the lawyer does a marvelous job connecting love of God with love of neighbor. And he gives the answer that I think we all instinctively know. What makes for true life, lasting life, eternal life, is love. And Jesus says, yeah, that's exactly it. You are right. If you follow this law of love, you will know what true life, eternal life is supposed to be. Now, you'd think that a lawyer would be happy simply to have gotten a thumbs up from Jesus. But he follows on. He does something quite loyally. What he does is he tries to find a loophole. Yes, he says, I get it. We're supposed to love God and we're supposed to love our neighbor, but that's hard to do. That's clearly impossible. So is there a loophole? Perhaps, says the lawyer, I can limit who my neighbor is. Surely, he says to Jesus, you can't mean everyone. Who is my neighbor, he asks. Now, look, I get this loophole kind of thinking. It makes a lot of sense to me. Because I, like I said before, would love to be a good Samaritan. I would love to be the person who helps, even though it is risky. I would love to be the person who doesn't walk by because I was too scared or because I was too busy. But can I be that all the time? If I'm really honest about myself, sometimes I'm one of the bad guys in this story and not the hero. Because I've walked by people in need. I've considered others beneath my attention. I've considered myself too busy or too important to stop and help. I've been the Levite and the priest who's walked by. And to be fair to me and to us, you know, it's harder for us than it was even for the lawyer back then. Because of the internet, we are exposed to so many overwhelming needs every single day. We have to walk by eventually, don't we? But even deeper, maybe even in the big scheme of things, I've been more like the bandits in the story than I'd like to admit. Because if I look at the great world around us and the intersection of global politics and economics, I benefit, and so do you, from others suffering and paying the price. It's never fun to embody the bad guys in one of Jesus' parables. And sometimes if I'm really honest, I understand that that comes from the fact that I don't actually have a deep and profound love for God or my neighbor, or really for that matter myself. I find it hard to dredge up that deep and profound and abiding love for God and for my neighbor and for myself. So the question, as we look at the parable of the Good Samaritan, the first question is not just how does the Good Samaritan inspire us to good deeds? The first question I think we must ask is how does the parable of the Good Samaritan fill us with the kind of love that God's law calls us to? What happens when we are no longer the Good Samaritan necessarily in the story? How then might we read it? Well, we are not the first to ask that question. Like I said before, this story has inspired reflection from the very moment it was told. From very early on, the church read the Good Samaritan deeply, and they saw it as a story that inspired good works and generosity and hospitality and risk-taking love. But the early church from the very beginning also read it as a deeper story. And that's where I want to begin as we start our three-week reflection on the Good Samaritan. If you read some of the early church authors, not the Bible, but the generation after, or maybe the second generation after the authors of the Bible, about 100 years after Jesus, when the church was still a rabble of Jews and Gentiles living in the shadow of the Roman Empire, well, you come across some interesting people. People like a man named Origen, who was an Egyptian theologian and teacher who reflected deeply on this story. And when he does that, he says he actually received his interpretation from his elders. So the generation just after the generation after Jesus, only a generation or two removed from the apostles and Jesus. And we see this same interpretation with few variations from many other early church leaders as well, Irenaeus and John Chrysostom, Ambrose, and of course the great Saint Augustine. The early church believed that this story was about helping others, inspiring us to be good Samaritans, but they believed that it worked at another level as well. They saw not just an inspiring story of occasional heroism. These early church teachers saw the Good Samaritan as a story of a person saturated with love in a world full of hate and greed and apathy. And that when Jesus talks about an act of supreme and sacrificial love for an outsider, he is actually talking about himself. And if Jesus is the Good Samaritan, then who is the lawyer and who are we? Well, perhaps the best case scenario is that we are the person injured and wounded and lying in a ditch. The early church read the story this way, and I'm not sure you'll agree with it, but I think it's quite interesting. For the early church, the man who goes on the journey from Jerusalem, high up on a hill, to Jericho, a city near the sea level, descends a great distance. And these teachers thought that it sounded a lot like the human race. We all, they said, move from the holy city of heaven to the city of death, a journey of deep descent. And on the way, we are attacked and left for dead by evil forces, sin and evil and the devil. And the story says that the man was left half dead, and they took this to mean that we are physically alive, but spiritually dead, just like us. And then they said, when the Levite and the priest go by, well, you know, those who have advice and holiness but don't lift a finger to help, well, perhaps they are like the law and religion who tell us what to do, sitting in judgment on the wounded and the broken but giving no strength to help. So who then is the Good Samaritan? The person saturated with love in a world of hate and greed and apathy? This person who makes an act of supreme and sacrificial love? This outsider, this foreigner, a person despised and rejected, he comes down the same road from Jerusalem to Jericho. And when he sees the victim in the ditch, he doesn't walk by. He stops and makes his problems his own. He binds his wounds with oil and wine. He places the man on his own animal and gave the innkeeper a blank check to take care of this person. And when he returned, promises that all the bills will be settled. And they said that the Samaritan was the God of love, who came down the same road as we did, who did not stand far off, but drew near to care for the victim, binding his wounds with the oil of gladness and the wine of good hope. Now, of course, some of these early authors suggested that this was Jesus himself, the Good Samaritan. But there's an interpretation that was a little offside, and Origen uses this one, and I quite like it. Someone a step further and suggested that Jesus was actually the most humble character in the story, the one that you've already forgotten about. Jesus was the beast of burden, the donkey upon which the broken man was placed, in the same way that in the body of Jesus our sins were placed. This early church, who knew the story of Jesus perhaps better than we do, were not ashamed to name Jesus as the humble beast, the servant of God, for the good of all people. The Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve. And then places this man in the local inn. The Samaritan, the God of grace, promises to pay every debt and cover every cost until the man is made whole. So when the early church read the story, they said, well, maybe we are the Good Samaritan, but maybe more importantly, it is Jesus who is the Samaritan, and perhaps strangely enough, even the donkey from whom every healing gift is given. It's not a radical idea that I've just come up with. It's one of the earliest readings of this story by people who were very close to the people that Jesus knew. And why did the early church read it this way? It seems maybe too complicated. Well, I think the reason they read it this way is the same reasons that we might. Because they knew and we know that we can't always be the Good Samaritan. In fact, more often than not, we are the person in the ditch, sinners, poor and needy, weak and wounded, sick and sore, as that old hymn says. Now, next week, we will talk about the call to serve and to love, to be good Samaritans. But before we go there, we need to understand what the early church understood. That before we think about becoming the Good Samaritan, we need to know that there is a Samaritan for us. That if we stumble and fall, if we are overtaken by evil, if we fall off our white horse, there is a humble donkey who will carry us when we can't walk ourselves. Listen, anyone who has truly sought to give their lives to the service of others knows how difficult it is and how necessary it is to find an identity that is not grounded in our performance or our success or our inspiring YouTube antics. We need an identity grounded in the love of God towards us. We need an identity grounded in grace. And the early church teachers read it this way because they knew that the only way to find life was to live a life of love, to be a person of sacrificial compassion. But the only way to live a life of love was to be filled with love. And when we read the story in this way, we start to understand, we start to feel, we start to experience that God's love for us is as generous and kind and abounding as the love the Samaritan shows to this man. To be a good Samaritan is a worthy goal, but it takes more than jujitsu or a good intention. It takes a heart that is bursting with love. If you really encounter the Good Samaritan, the Great Samaritan, and his humble donkey, if you encounter the God of love in the person of Jesus receiving you, loving you, refusing to give up on you, then you will find over time love growing within you. And this love will enable and empower you to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and to love your neighbor as yourself. As the Apostle Paul says, we love because God first loved us. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.